In the last section, we want to start to look at dust and the interaction of radiation with dust. So far we were looking at charged single particles. And dust creates four observable effects in its interaction with radiation. We have the extinction of stellar radiation. So we have radiation not being able to pass through a certain volume of dust. And this is, for example, visible here on the right-hand side, where we see the Horst Nebula, this dark horse-shaped cloud, and the lack of stars here in this green shaded region, and that is because the dust cloud is intransparent to the optical radiation from the stars behind this cloud. This is the extinction. We might also observe scattering of stellar radiation, which is basically a scattering of light off the dust particles. This is observed here in the bottom left, where we have the Pleiades. And when we look at here this blue shaded region around the stars, it was very early recognized that the light coming from here, for example, this bluish light, has the same spectral shape as the light coming directly from the stars. And this has been interpreted as radiation being emitted by the star, hitting dust particles here, and then being reflected and scattered directly in direction of our detector. So this is scattering. We also observe polarization. Dust particles are able to polarize radiation either by selective absorption or by emission by themselves. And we also can observe the actual black body radiation, the thermal emission of dust particles, which are solid particles, which is a solid body, so we can observe thermal emission. And we start by looking at the interstellar extinction, which is described by the Lambert-Baer law, which describes the attenuation of light due to a certain optical depth. So we have light entering here this box, and we have a diminished amount of light leaving the box. This is described by the Lambert-Baer law, which states that the intensity leaving this volume is the initial E background intensity times E to the minus tau, where tau is the optical depth of this volume. The optical depth itself is described as a quantity that depends on the number density of particles, of optically active particles in this volume, times the path length through the volume, times the extinction cross-section, which is describing basically the amount of absorption per particle per path length through this volume. This is the extinction cross-section. And when we take the first two, the product between the first two, this is the column density of dust, which is n times L, number density of dust times L. in astronomical units, this extinction is expressed as the visual extinction A, which is a logarithmic unit that logarithmically describes the ratio between the final and the initial intensity, so the ratio I over I background, taking the logarithm of this and multiplying it with minus 2.5 gives the extinction. And this can be converted to the optical depth by multiplication with 1.086. This is a frequency-dependent quantity because the extinction cross-section depends on the frequency, and a standard wavelength that is used to describe the extinction is the optical V-filter at 550 nanometer, and then this is called AV, the so-called visual extinction. This is a AV is a property that correlates to the total gas column density, assuming that we have a fixed ratio, a fixed gas to dust ratio, which is assumed here, then we can express the AV as 5.34 times 10 to the minus 22 magnitudes times column density given in units of hydrogen atoms per square centimeter. So we need approximately 0.5 times 10 to the 22 hydrogen atoms, a column density of 5 times 10 to the 21 per cubic centimeter to create a visual extinction of 1. So here NH is the total proton column density, which is of course the sum of the H atom column density plus 2 times the molecular hydrogen column density. The factor 2 here accounts for the fact that hydrogen consists of 2 particles. And we assume an average dust to gas mass ratio of 1%. The number density ratio is much smaller, but since one dust particle is significantly heavier than a single hydrogen atom, we find a mass ratio of 1 to 100. I already mentioned that this extinction is wavelength dependent, and it is weaker for longer wavelengths. This is shown here in this plot of the Bock globule B68. On the left-hand side, we see the visual filter where the actual volume of the cloud here creates basically the extinction of all the light from the background stars. However, when we look at the region here, we note that there is a gradient, so the number of stars slowly goes down from outside of the cloud to the center of the cloud. This is of course because when we have like a spherical shape here, the column density grows when we go from the edge further to the center. But we also note that the color of stars here is red, while we have here all kinds of colors. You see we have reddish stars, more bluish, yellowish, white stars. So the color changes from here to here. And when we look at the same region in longer wavelengths, the extinction becomes smaller, and the cloud becomes transparent to the background radiation of the star. This is shown here on the right-hand side. We see in red the light of all the background stars and their longer wavelength radiation can penetrate the cloud, while the shorter wavelength radiation is absorbed. And this selective extinction creates a reddening effect because red light is less strongly absorbed than bluer light, so the overall light is reddened. So the reason is this strong wavelength dependence of the extinction, which is in the UV about 3 times higher than in the visual. And in the infrared, it is much, much smaller. So dust becomes transparent in the infrared, which makes infrared astronomy so interesting because it allows us to actually observe the center of molecular clouds, which is unobservable in other frequency bands, where we can only penetrate to a certain maximum extinction. So this is shown in a comparison of the Milky Way in these two bands that I plot here in the center. In the bottom, you see the visual with all the dark bands created by dusty clouds in the plane of the Milky Way, while in the infrared, here we cannot see the molecular clouds by their extinction. Sometimes we can observe them here, this reddening of the very densest parts. So we have the counterparts here, but we still see radiation from the background. So this is in the B filter, which is blue light at 445 nanometers. And this reddening is described with the selective extinction. So RV is the factor, is the ratio between the visual extinction and the difference between the blue and the visual extinction, which basically describes the slope of the extinction law in the visible range. So the reddening is the ratio between the visual and the offset of the blue and the visual. So how much stronger or weaker the extinction is in the visual relative to the blue. And typical values for the interstellar medium range from around 3 for the diffuse medium to around 5 to 6 for the dense clouds. And the extinction curves are shown here on the right-hand side. We have 3 curves showing the same slope for the very long wavelengths. So we have here the x-axis is in inverse wavelengths. So left-hand side is large wavelengths, right-hand side is short wavelengths, and one is basically at 1 micrometer. The optical range is at around 500, which is 2 here. So this is around the visual range. And then we have the UV here. So we see that the slopes change here, depending on the kind of medium. And this is described by the RV. One possible physical reason is that a higher RV is produced by larger grains, which can happen in denser clouds due to more frequent collision between dust grains that then coagulate and stick to each other. The denominator here, this AB minus AV, is a relative constant quantity no matter what the medium is, and can be given as 1.7 times 10 to the minus 23 magnitudes times the proton column density in hydrogen atoms per square centimeter. So this total extinction curve shows, first of all, that we have a dominance of this reddening effect. So we have weaker extinction at longer wavelengths. And all the information on the dust is encoded in the extinction curve. So for example, we observe here this bump at 217 nanometers, which is called the graphite bump, and is most likely produced by the solid body contribution of graphite to the dust particle. So we can see practically that graphite is one of the components of the interstellar dust grain population. Here on this plot, we see also that the extinction curve changes on the right hand side depending on whether we look at the Milky Way, which is here. LMC is the Large Magellanic Cloud, and SMC is the Small Magellanic Cloud. And one of the main differences between LMC, SMC, and the Milky Way is the content of heavier elements, which is smallest for the SMC. So this is for low, what is called metallicity, where we have a significant stronger reddening effect here, a steeper curve on the short wavelengths end. In terms of modeling, the main parameter that is used to actually describe the dust extinction is the Cx, so the extinction coefficient. And this can be not measured directly because we have no in situ knowledge of the dust. So we have to, from theoretical assumptions, compute what certain dust compositions would look like here in these extinction curves. To do this, we have to solve the fundamental scattering problem. So we have to solve the Maxwell equations for an incoming plane wave hitting a dust grain and then being scattered as an outgoing spherical wave. So this can be treated as a 2D problem given sufficient symmetry of the dust particle as a function of the incoming and the outgoing wave directions, which is then described by the scattering matrix S, which is a function of the scattering angle theta. So generally, such a scattering of an electromagnetic wave can be described by the vector, which gives here the scattered E field split into its parallel direction and the scattering plane direction, And this is here the wave term e to the ikt, ikr. Actually here, normalized with minus ikr times the scattering matrix, which has four components, times the initial E field described also in this parallel and perpendicular directions. So we have the spherical wave, we have the scattering matrix, and we have the incident field. And k again is the wave number 2 pi frequency over c. Parallel means the direction that is parallel to the normal vector of the scattering plane, and the perpendicular is the component which is in the scattering plane. So the scattering amplitude from the scattering matrix is a function of the angle theta. Which is here given by these four components again, which determines then the vector of the scattered E field. All the individual elements of S are complex and contain absorption and scattering physics, basically. The result can then be described by cross sections, where we have the scattering cross section. We have the absorption cross-section. We have the extinction cross-section, which is the sum of scattering plus absorption. So extinction describes all the radiation that will not reach the exit of our volume, either because radiation is being scattered away, so moving in different direction, or because radiation is absorbed by the dust, so the energy is actually contained in the dust. And we can also compute the albedo, which is the ratio between scattered and extincted radiation. So here, if we have a lot of absorption, the denominator is large, so we have a low albedo. If we have dominating scattering, we have basically an albedo approaching unity. So, for example, the scattering cross-section can be computed by taking the integral over 4 pi, so over all solid angles, of x squared divided by k squared. The extinction cross-section is 4 pi over k squared times the real part of x times the direction vector in the direction of theta equals zero. So this is the forward direction, and accordingly the extinction cross-section describes the parts of the energy that are missing in the forward, in the look-through direction. The angular behavior can be described in the so-called phase function, which is 1 over c scattering, times the change of the scattering cross section with solid angle. So this describes the angular dependence. An alternative description is because the units of C are in actual area units, also for example square centimeter, so the geometric equivalent of a blocking area. So what area, what is the effective blocking area for the radiation? We can divide this by the actual geometric cross-section of the dust particles and then describe scattering or extinction in units of their efficiency. These are the Q factors, the extinction efficiency, which is the cross-section, the extinction cross-section divided by the geometric cross-section. So, for example, assuming a spherical particle with radius a, qx would be cx divided by pi times a squared.